Jazakallah. Thank you, Dr. Zakir Naik. We now move on to the second part of the program, which is the question and answer session. For the purpose of the question and answer session, may we have slips of papers being sent over here so that we may pose these questions, as well as those of you who are interested in asking questions directly to Dr. Zakir Naik. There are two mics that have been provided in the auditorium. You have one in the ladies section, and sisters who are keen on asking questions to Dr. Zakir Naik may pose questions to him on the mic over there. And we have one over here right in the front next to the stage, and members of the gents audience who wish to ask questions may also do so. Let me briefly tell you what should be the guidelines that we would like to observe during the question and answer session so that we derive maximum benefit. One person at a time would be allowed to ask a question. If you have more than one question, please await your turn at the end of the queue so that when your chance comes, you can ask your second question. After you have asked a question, please do not go back to your seat. Remain standing at your position so that Dr. Zakir Naik can address you while answering your question. May we have the questions over here so that we can begin soon, please. Please, sister, may we have your first question?
Okay. Assalamu alaikum. In an attempt to promote Islam, is it all right to quote from the translations of the Quran? And if so, how do we know which translations are authentic?
The sister asked a question that while promoting Islam, giving the message of Islam, can we quote the translation of the glorious Quran? And if we have to do, then how do you know which is authentic? Sister, there are various translations available in the languages. As I told you, approximately 100, a little bit more than 100. What do you have to do, sister? A person who's an expert in both the languages, Urdu and Arabic. You have to ask the person who's well-versed in both the languages, which is a better translation? The best, what I always say, that if every Muslim knows Arabic as a language himself, that's the best. So he himself can judge what is right, what is wrong. He himself can get the message of the Quran directly and then propagate amongst the people. But since I know that 80% of the Muslim world doesn't know Arabic, what you can do is that you can ask the person who's an expert in that field, who knows that language, maybe Malayalam or maybe Tamil, whatever language it is, and Arabic, and see whether it's right or wrong. And those people are well-versed in both the languages. They will be able to tell you which translation is correct. Or you can compare the various translations that you have. If there are more than one, if there are 10, you can compare, and you'll find that majority of the places, they are common. In some places, there are different opinions. So when the places of different opinion arises, that time you can go and ask a person who's well-versed in both the languages, which is more correct. And a person who has knowledge of the Sahih Hadith also. Besides having knowledge of the Quran, many times the commentary of the Quran is given in Sahih Hadith. So a person who's well-versed with Quran and Sahih Hadith, he will be in a better position to explain to you that which commentary is better and which translation is better. Hope that answers the question.
We have received certain slips of questions over here. The first question that is posed to Dr. Zakir Naik is that the media always portrays Muslims to be very ruthless and barbaric. And one of the instances that they quote very often is the slaughtering of animals. Why do Muslims slaughter the animals in a ruthless manner by torturing it slowly and painfully killing it is a common question that a lot of non-Muslims writers portray in the media. How does one answer this onslaught?
The brother posed a question, and it's a good question, that the media and non-Muslims, they portray Islam as a ruthless religion, as a merciless religion, and they quote an instance that why do Muslims, when you all kill the animal, when you all eat the animal, you all slaughter in a particular fashion, so ruthlessly, you all torture him slowly and you make him die slowly and so painfully, why not directly in one shot, one chatka finish, why are you all so ruthless? And one, there was an argument going on between a Muslim and a Sikh. You know, a Sikh is a person who comes mainly from Punjab, you know. They start from there, Sikh is a person who wears the turban, they are Sikhs. We have approximately 2% of Sikhs in India. So once a Muslim brother of ours and a Sikh was having a discussion. And the Sikh was saying, oh, you Muslims, you all are ruthless people. You all torture the animal painfully. Why don't just give one jhatka and finish the animal is dead? Why kill the animal so mercilessly? So our Muslim brother, he replied, that see, you Sikhs, you are a coward people. You attack from behind. Muslims, we are marad ka bacha, we attack from the front. This was a battle of wits. It's not the right answer. It's a battle of wits. He didn't know, so he said, oh, you are a coward people, attack from behind. We are marad ka bacha, we are brave, courageous, we attack from the front. That's not the answer why the Muslims slaughter. That he was using his hikmah. The reason that the Muslim do zabiha is the Arabic word for the Islamic way of sacrifice, of slaughtering, is Zabiha. Is during Zabiha, there are certain conditions that the knife should be sharp and the cut should be quick and various conditions. And amongst them, the main is that you should take the name of Allah and you should even cut the windpipe and the vessels of the neck, the jugular veins and the arteries out here you should cut. The reason that we cut the windpipe and the jugular veins and the vessels of the neck is because when we cut, we should see to it that we don't damage the spinal column. Only cutting the front part, the animal is yet alive. The heart is yet pumping. So when the animal is yet alive and the heart is yet pumping, the majority of the blood flows out of the body of the animal. Majority of the blood. The reason that we want the blood to flow out of the animal's body is because today science tells us that blood is a very good media of germ, bacteria and toxins. And if we have this blood along with the meat, there are high chances that you may get various diseases. So we Muslims, we are hygienic people. That's the reason when we slaughter in the Islamic fashion. And besides that, meat, which is slaughtered by the Islamic way of Zabiha, remains fresh for a longer time, as compared to meat by chatka, directly with the one shot or by stunning or letting the blood remain. Because blood is a good media of germ and bacteria, the meat can get rotten very fast. So it remains fresh for a longer time. And besides that, if you analyze, it's a misconception that the animal feels pain. Because when we do zabiha, when we slaughter, and we cut the vessels of the neck, the blood supply, which goes to the nerve, which is responsible for feeling of the pain, that blood supply is cut off. So the animal does not feel pain. The blood supply going to the nerve, which is responsible for feeling of pain, is severe. So the animal does not feel pain. I do know that the animal kicks and writhes, but the kicking and writhing is due to the gush of flow of blood. It is not due to pain. In fact, on the other hand, in stunning, when you hit the animal hard, the animal feels tremendous pain. Here, it's a quick cut, and the blood supply to the nerve going is severe, and the animal does not feel pain. He dies after a few minutes, 3-4 minutes, but it's not torture to death. In stunning, very often the animal dies after 5 minutes, very often. Sometimes may die on the spot, but very often, even that animal also shivers. But in the Zabiha method, he does not feel pain. Even stunning directly also if he dies, yet it is more inhuman than the Islamic method in which the blood flows out, germ and bacteria is less, the meat remains fresh for a longer time, and the animal does not.
May we have the next question, please?
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Junaida from Mangalore. Some Maulvis say that journalism is not a good profession for Muslims. They say it consists more of ghibat, which Islam does not permit. But brother, even I'm unhappy to say that those are the ones who do not forget to read the rumors page when they have the paper in their hand.
The sister has posed the question that some of the Maulvis say that journalism is not a good profession because it consists of ghibat, and besides that, these are the same people who, when read the newspaper, they read the newspaper of humor or rumors, whatever it is. So isn't these people are contradicting? Sister, journalism is of various types. Why do those Maulvis read, whether they read or not, I don't know, sisters. Whether the Maulvis read rumor or don't read rumor, I'm not aware of that. You can ask, each individual Maulvi is a different person, so you can't just blame all Maulvis together. You can't paint all the people with the same brush. I don't know which Maulvi you are referring to. But coming to the first part of the question, that some people say that journalism involves ghibat. Sister, journalism is of various types. You have genuine journalism, yellow journalism, where you simply malign people. You have journalism which is good. And you have to follow the basic guidelines of the Quran, which says in Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse 81, وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقُّ وَزَاقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوكَ. When truth is heard again, falsehood, falsehood perishes. For falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. So if you are doing journalism, see to it that you always speak the truth. I do know the Quran says ghibat is wrong in Surah Humazah, chapter 104, verse number 1. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Woe to every kind of scandalmonger and backbiter. The Quran says in Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, verse number 11 and 12, that do not backbite. If you backbite, it's as though you're eating the meat of a dead brother. I do know backbiting is wrong. So in journalism, you don't have to backbite, sister. And one more thing is there, that what is made public, suppose a person does something evil, and if you warn the people that this person is a bad person, that's not called a backbiting. If you call a backbiting outside, that type of backbiting is allowed in Islam. Where if you're warning someone, for example, the Hadith of beloved Prophet says that if somebody comes to ask you that you want to marry so and so person, and you know the background of that person, you say, no, that boy is not good, he has alcohol. If that's called backbiting, that type is allowed. Because they're warning the persons against certain harm. So if you're warning the people of the Ummah against certain harm of certain person, this type is allowed in Islam. So in journalism, if it's the truth, and you warn the people against some calamity, against certain evil, Islam gives you permission. But don't write wrong things just to earn money. So that article will sell, and you speak against someone so that that person gets a vote, or somebody gives you money, 10,000 rupees, okay, write against this politician, write against this institute, write against this group. All this happens, you know. It happens more in the Muslim press. That you take this money and write against this organization, you take this money, write in favor of this organization. This type of journalism is haram. If it's a fact, you can very well say, sister, and we require journalists. It's part of da'wah. It's a part of the duty of the Muslim Ummah to spread the message of Islam. Today is the age of journalism, technology, satellite, etc. You have to utilize this media to spread Islam, sister. Hope that answers the question.
Do we have any questions from the gents section?
Assalamu alaikum. I am Hashim Ali. Brother Zakir Naik, my question is, it was published in an article, I can't remember that magazine name, regarding Miraj of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It says, in the 6th century, a fool claimed that he went to heaven. How we the Muslim Ummah clear this type of misconception?
The brother asked me a question that he read an article that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to heaven. How can Muslim Ummah create such a misconception? Whether prophets have been given various miracles, and prophets can do miracles, they are signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What are referring to the Mi'raj of beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The references are given in the Quran in Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse number 1, that the Prophet was transported from Masjid al-Haram to Masjid al-Aqsa. Masjid al-Haram to Masjid al-Aqsa, and then you read in the Sahih Hadith in Sahih Bukhari that the Prophet went to the heavens, etc. It's a fact. Thing is that these are miracles. Like the Quran says that Musa alayhi salam split the ocean into two, the sea into two. Isa alayhi salam, he was born without a male intervention. These are miracles. Neither can science disprove, neither can science confirm. That goes in the ambiguous slot. What we say, these were the prophets of God, they were messenger of God, they were given certain miracles. So these were done with the permission and will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hope that answers the question.
We have a brother by the name of Jose Matthew whose question is, why do Muslims call Islam as the best religion when there are many Muslims who are unreliable and dishonest? These Muslims are involved in activities such as frauds, bribing, cheating, or dealing in drugs. Can you please explain?
The question posed was that why do you call Islam as the best way of life when you find Muslims dealing in drugs, dealing in alcohol, cheating, etc.? Why Islam is the best? You can refer to my video cassette. I've given the talk, Islam, the Universal Religion, Islam, Introduction, and there I've proven that why Islam is the best way of life. For Islam not only speaks good things, it shows you a way how to achieve that good things. And if you heard in my talk, I always speak about Islam as the best way of life. The reason that you find that, you know, people saying Muslims are bad, they deal in alcohol, they deal in drugs, they deal in this. I do know that there are black sheep in every community. I do know Muslims, though Quran says alcohol is prohibited, some Muslim can drink the non-Muslim under the table. I do know that. The media is in the hands of the Western world. The media projects Islam in the wrong way. We do have black sheep in the community, even in Islam, even in Muslims we have black sheep. As I give the example, that if you find one Arab, age of 50, marrying a girl of 16 years old, it comes a headline in the paper. You know, as though every day you find thousands of Arabs marrying 16 years old girls. As we're projecting it that way. And on the other hand, when you have a non-Muslim, 50 years old man, raping a 10 years old girl, it's nowhere there in the news. See, media is in their hand. So they influence the people to make Muslims look like terrorists, like fundamentalists, like bad people. They project it that way. So because media is in their hand, they give a wrong picture. I'm not saying that we don't have Muslims who are bad. Actually, a Muslim cannot be bad. Because Muslim means one who submits the will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he submits the will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will not gamble, he will not rob, he will not have drug, he will not rape, he will not molest. These Muslims, they are namesake Muslims. They are lip service Muslims. They are pseudo-Muslims. They aren't true Muslims. They are black sheep in our community. But in spite of this, alhamdulillah, yet as a whole, Muslim as a whole, yet alhamdulillah, with all the drawbacks that we have, yet alhamdulillah, we are the biggest community of teetotalers. Teetotalers means we don't touch alcohol as a whole. We're the biggest community that gives maximum charity with all our drawbacks, alhamdulillah. We are the community which has the maximum modesty, maximum sobriety, alhamdulillah, with all the black sheep in our community. So firstly, I blame the media. And besides that, even if someone says that, okay, Muslims are bad. Suppose, hypothetically, I do agree that most of the Muslims are bad, hypothetically. But what I say, in my talk, I speak about Islam as the best way of life. I don't speak about Muslims as the best. And if suppose you want to judge a car, suppose you have a Mercedes car, and you want to analyze how good the car is. A person who does not know how to drive the car, he sits on the steering wheel and he bangs up the car. Who will you blame? Will you blame the car or the driver? Who will you blame? The driver. The driver did not know how to drive the car. He didn't have a license. First time he's driving a car. Similarly, if there are Muslims who are not practicing Islam correctly, blame the Muslims, not the religion. If you want to judge the religion, judge according to authentic sources, the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. And if you want an exemplary Muslim, the best Muslim example is our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's no better example. If you want to judge a car, put the best driver and then judge it. The best person, best exemplary Muslim, as the Quran says in Surah Qalam, chapter 68, verse number 4, verily thou art standard on the highest standard of character. Quran says in Surah Azab, chapter 33, verse 21, that verily in the messenger you'll find the most beautiful pattern of conduct. The best example is the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's the best example. If you want to judge Islam, judge by his behavior. No wonder Michael H. Hart, a person who's an American, who's a Christian, who wrote a book on the 100 most influential people in history. The 100 most influential people in history, right from Adam, peace be upon him, till present time. And number one he gave Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He's not a Muslim. Why should he give Prophet Muhammad number one, peace be upon him? It's a fact. He was an honest person. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, number three. Number one is Muhammad, peace be upon him. Best exemplary. I do know people say, oh, you know, you're fine, that you find no Muslim country which is good, and there goes a bad thing, and this thing. I said, see, I do know that there's not a single country in the world who's following Islam in toto. But there are countries which follow certain parts. Those countries which follow criminal law, you find crime the least in that country. Those which follow the economic law, you find economics the best in that country. If you want to judge any community as a whole, a country or a state which are the best, at the time of the beloved Prophet, best example, at the time of the four rightly guided Khalifas, Hazrat Abu Bakr, Hazrat Umar, Hazrat Usman, Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with them all. Best example, see the community at that time. It was the best. If you want to judge as a state, by implementing Islamic law completely, what results come? See the times of the rightly guided Khalifa and the time of the beloved Prophet. That's the best. Hope that answers the question.
May we have the next question from the sister's side.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Naushin, from a school student from Mangalore. My question is a Muslim woman with full parda allowed to work in television for news broadcast station as it takes place in Saudi Arabia?
The sister asked a question that can a woman in full parda, you are referring to face being open, I believe. Face being open, na?
Cover. Eyes are open.
Sorry?
Eyes can be seen.
Eyes can be seen. I think covered. Sister is saying that if a lady is supposed to give a news on a television with full face covered, only eyes can be seen, and she gives the news, is it allowed? Sister, if you have all the men in the Muslim world dead, then I would say no problem. Are the men dead? A man giving with proper clothes is much more better, impactfully better. The thing is that when dawah should be done, the women should do among women, the men among men. Sometimes it can be done on different levels, like on a stage I'm doing and people are watching, no problem. On one-to-one basis, etc. The women are supposed to maintain the hijab. And it is again the principle of hijab that the women come on the television. Television. So it's much more preferred that, but naturally, a man should do it. If all the men are dead in the world, all the Muslim men, and then if you ask me the question, I say, okay, maybe, I've got no objection. But you have many men, alhamdulillah. So what the women, I've got no objection if the audience is only women. Then she can even uncover her face, she can even uncover her head and give a talk, give a lecture, no problem, only females. Because you know, Islam believes as far as possible segregation of sexes. So when it comes to giving news reading, there's bound to be various men who may not lower their gaze properly, who may not listen to the news properly, it will be wrong on your part to allow them to have that thing. So it's preferable that men read the news in these conditions. Hope that answers the question.
May we have the next question, please?
Dr. Zayat Naik, Zakir Naik, my name is Mehboob Khan. I am from Mangalore. I am engaged in agriculture. So you have been talking very concernedly about the readership of the newspapers, non-electronic media. Hopefully, we have a situation, our education system is so poor that naturally we cannot expect any readership there. And as far as the English papers, very few English papers that are concerned. In 1992, I remembered having picked up a copy of Islamic Voice that they had featured the death of Muhammad Asad. And that the feature, it was written that he was born in Australia. If the administration of a paper is lacking so much in the geography, as from Australia, they cannot make a difference as between Australia and Austria. It is, I mean, how can you expect a non-Muslim to appreciate a paper? And the grammatical mistakes are, I'm sorry, Dr. Naik, my question is not within the definition of a question. You may have to bear with me for a few moments.
Please, may I request you to come to your question?
No,
the entire thing, entire lecture of today is, I mean, what you call, centered upon the lack of, I mean, what you call mass communication, and we don't have the education amongst the Muslims.
It's a wonderful question, brother. The brother asked a good question, that today in the Muslim Ummah, you don't have proper education, and we don't have proper training, etc. So my lecture is based on that. That's why I'm giving a talk to inspire. There may be certain philanthropists here, or may see the Qasid who may start having good education. And I've given a talk on Islam for children, showing how to start schools based on the Quran and Hadith. How can you have good school in the modern times, having the knowledge of modern world as well as Quran Hadith simultaneously? I've given talks for that also. The brother said that he read Islamic Voice, Muhammad Asad. He's born in Austria, that I know, but they mentioned by mistake Australia. How can they make a difference? The difference only of Austria and Australia, AL, is added extra. So, brother, do you know Times of India is supposed to be the best paper, correct, in India? Times of India. Brother, do you know or not? Times of India in English is supposed to be one of the best. Right or wrong? Yes. I appreciate it. Do you know, I find on the first page, minimum 20 mistakes. Minimum 20 mistakes. Minimum 20 mistakes. A person should be trained to find out the mistake. I do know, even in Times of India, first page only, minimum you'll find either spacing mistake, either comma mistake, either grammatical, and they have the best people in Times of India. Less mistakes you have in weekly paper and monthly paper, I don't know. That doesn't mean I'm supporting Islamic Voice. I'm not supporting. What I'm telling you, Alhamdulillah, with whatever limited thing he had, at least he's doing what you should say. I will start a newspaper, inshallah, there will not be a single mistake. We Muslims have a habit of pointing at the finger. Oh, he's not doing it. I'm not blaming you, brother. I'm not blaming you. I'm not telling you are doing that. I'm giving the Muslim view. I'm not telling you are blaming. What we should do, we should say, okay, I will start a paper better than Islamic Voice. Alhamdulillah. No problem. But if you can't, at least support that paper. We should not pull each other's leg. What we are doing, Muslims are wasting more time. If I want a paper, what you should do, you should support that paper and then we'll make a new paper. We in IRF, we support the other Dawah organization. We don't say, oh, this Jamaat Islami is wrong, so I'll pull him down. This Salafi organization is wrong. Support everyone and you do Dawah. Because we are doing for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Support all the organization, whatever is coming, support them and even you do. Don't pull each other's leg. Least you can do is stay neutral. Least. That itself is great. But Muslim organization pulling each other's leg, this organization, I want to pull his leg, so that people will think I'm the best. When you will be best? Arre, when you support everyone, Allah will help you. If you get Allah's help, that's the best. And I do agree with the brother that today what we're lacking is basic education. How many institutes do we have today who we can call excel in the field of education? Even if I have to send my son, who's about 4 years now, I doubt whether I'll send him to a Muslim school. We have Muslim schools in Bombay, but the level of education is atrocious. I'm sorry to say, I know these people, they may be good people in the institution, but if you compare them with the missionary schools, their education is much higher. What do we do? If you feel that you cannot give a proper Islamic background to your school, yet put them in Muslim school. But if you're confident that you can give Islamic background at home and put them in missionary schools, and your son can do Dawah in missionary school, then you can put them in missionary school. Otherwise, don't put. Don't put him in state school. If you have confidence that you can give enough Islamic knowledge, the parents themselves don't know Islam, what will they teach their children? If you are confident enough that you can train your child enough about Islam and even do dawah in that school, then I've got no objection if he goes to Mishnah school. Otherwise, put him in a Muslim school, even if the Muslim school standard is low. At least his iman will be safe. Otherwise, he goes and becomes a doctor and goes far away from Islam. What is the use? So what we require, brother, now is institutions which are excelling in education, in modern education as well as deen together. Unfortunately, we have a segregation. The dini madaris, those that teach Quran fiqh separately and those which teach modern education separately. Even Quran is modern. We require a striking balance between the both. Teach both simultaneously. There are very few such organizations in the world which teach both simultaneously. Islamic values, Quran, Hadith, Sharia, and the education which we learn in science and technology, etc. If we have this, and then if we excel our people in this field, inshallah this will not be there. And we have to train our people. How to do proofreading is a technique. How to record mistake is technique that when in journalism also, those people have done the course of journalism will realize that taking out mistake is also technique. So more experienced a Muslim is in that field, the paper will be better. Hope that answers the question.
There's a question posed by a member of the audience saying that Islam is often made a target in the media, mentioning that Islam is very intolerant and it's very fundamentalist. And they mentioned that non-Muslims are not allowed in the city of Mecca and Medina, which are the holy sites of Islam. Why is this so? Why are non-Muslims not allowed in the holy city of Mecca?
The question posed is that Islam is an intolerant religion, they are fundamentalist. Why aren't the non-Muslims allowed in the city of Mecca? Regarding that Islam are fundamentalist, etc., I've given the talk on is religious fundamentalism a stumbling block to the freedom of expression. It's a debate between myself and the other speakers. You can refer to that cassette. That cassette will give the answer in detail about fundamentalism or terrorists, etc. Regarding the main question, that why aren't non-Muslims allowed in the holy city of Mecca? Why aren't? See, if you analyze that even an Indian, suppose I'm an Indian, and I'm an Indian, even if I have to go, in certain areas I'm not allowed to go in India. Those are the cantonment area. You know cantonment, the military area? The government doesn't give me permission to go in that area, though I am a bona fide citizen of India. Yet the Indian government will not allow me to go in certain areas which are known as cantonment area. Those are special areas for those people who are well-versed and mainly meant for protecting the country and they're trained in that, etc. Other normal citizens aren't allowed. Similarly, Islam is for the whole world, for all the human beings. But the cantonment area of Islam, the peaceful area, what we call, is the Haramain, Makkah and Medina. Here, no one besides the staunch believers of Islam can go. That's the cantonment area. You cannot go without being a staunch believer. Otherwise, Islam is for all human beings. Not that we are against them. But whenever you want to enter any country, you require a visa. If I have to go to America, to England, to Singapore, to Malaysia, I apply for a visa. And when I apply for visa, there are certain questionnaires, certain questions I have to answer, certain things I have to agree with. For example, when I go to Singapore, it was mentioned in the form, immigration form, death to drug traffickers, death penalty to all those who deal with drug. I cannot say, oh, this punishment is very harsh. I don't agree with this. If you don't agree, no entry in Singapore. So if I have to enter Singapore, I have to agree that if I am caught with drug, I will be hanged. Death penalty. No option. If you don't agree with that law, don't enter the country. So if you want to apply for a visa, you have to agree with the laws of that country. Similarly, if any human being wants to enter Makkah or Medina, you have to apply for a visa. The visa for Makkah and Medina is to say with your lips verbally, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the messenger of Allah, and no one can prevent you from entering there.
Brother Surinder Rao is keen on asking Dr. Zakir Naik, why do Muslims call Almighty God Allah?
The question posed was by Brother Surinder Rao, that why do Muslims call God by the name Allah? The glorious Quran says in Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse 110, قُلِ ذُ اللَّهِ عَوِدُ الرَّحْمَانِ أَيَأْمَا تَدُوْ فَلَّهُ الْأَسْنَى الْحُسْنَى. Say, call upon him by Allah or by call upon him by Rahman. By whichever name you call upon him, to him belongs the most beautiful name. You can call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by any name, but it should be a beautiful name. It should not conjure up a mental picture. And the Quran gives this message in Surah Araf chapter 7 verse 180, Surah Taha chapter 20 verse number 8, and Surah Al-Hashr chapter 59 verse number 24, that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs the most beautiful name. And there are no less than 99 different attributes given to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the glorious Quran, like Rahman, Rahim, Al-Hakim, most merciful, most gracious, most wise. 99 attributes. And the crowning one is Allah. Why do we Muslims prefer calling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the Arabic name Allah instead of the English word God? It's because the English word God, you can play mischief with that English word God. For example, if you add a S to God, it becomes gods. That means plural of God. There's nothing like plural Allah in Islam. Kul hu Allahu ahad. Say He's Allah one and only. If you add a D-E-S-S to God, it becomes goddess. That means a female God. There's nothing like male Allah or female Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unique. Allah has got no gender. If you add a father to God, it becomes Godfather. He's my Godfather. He's my guardian. There's nothing like Allah Father or Allah Abba in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unique word. If you add a mother to God, it becomes Godmother. There's nothing like Allah Mother or Allah Ami in Islam. If you prefix sin before God, it becomes sin God. That means a fake God. There's nothing like sin Allah in Islam. Therefore, we Muslims, we prefer calling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the Arabic name Allah instead of the English word God.
May we have the question from the sister's side, please?
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Dianis. I'm studying for BDS. Brother, isn't it said that during days of Prophet, Aisha radiallahu anha used to deliver speeches to the Sahabis? So isn't it important that women scholars today should also make use of media like television in Dawah, provided they are in hijab?
Sister asked a very good question, and she quoted a reference that Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she used to give speeches to the Sahabas, and she is said to have taught no less than 88 different scholars. She was a scholar of scholar, and only on her authority there are 2,210 ahadith narrated, and I do agree with that. But sister, the reason was Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she was the wife of beloved Prophet, and she was close to the Prophet, and she had memorized various ahadith which no one in the Muslim Ummah at that time knew. So she was the scholar of the scholar. She had the maximum knowledge. So if you have an option to go to a lady who has maximum knowledge as compared to a gent which has no knowledge at all, then going to a lady is allowed. So today also, if a situation arises where you have a Muslimah, a Muslim woman who is excellent in knowledge, then if a group of men want to go to her for knowledge, they can go. But even when Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, when she gave, she maintained a hijab. Many a time it was through a curtain, not face to face. It was through a curtain that they used to give, because the wife of the Prophet had to maintain extra hijab. And the main point was because she was the human being who had one of the highest knowledge. She had certain knowledge which none of the Sahabis had. So in this situation, but natural, even today you can speak to a woman, not that you can't speak, you can get trained on a woman, but if you know that there is a man who has more knowledge than a woman, so the men should prefer to go to the men and the woman to a woman. Similarly, if a woman wants to gain knowledge, and if there's no other woman who has equal knowledge as that of a man, then she can go to a man to get knowledge. But if you tell me that a man in this world today has more knowledge than a woman, and yet you go to a woman, then that doesn't serve the purpose. It's unnecessary breaking the hijab. But even if you have to go to a woman, you can go, but it is within the purview of Islam that Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she used to speak very often in the curtain. So now also if that situation arises, sister, very well, the woman can give knowledge if they feel they are the best in the world and no one has equivalent knowledge to them in that field of fiqh or field of Islam. They can give, maintain the Islamic hijab. Hope that answers the question.
There's a non-Muslim brother by the name of Jagdish who makes a reference to one of Dr. Zakir Naik's talks yesterday. His question is, Brother Jagdish would like to know, if prophets were sent to every nation of the world, then which prophets were sent to India? Can Ram, Krishna, etc. be considered prophets of God? Second but related question is, if several revelations were sent by God before the Quran, can we consider the Vedas or the Bhagavad Gita, etc. as the word of God?
The question posed was that if prophets were sent to each and every nation, as the Quran says, in Surah Fatir, chapter 35, verse 24, وَإِمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خِلَافِ النَّزِيرِ. There is not a nation or a tribe to whom we have not sent a warner or a guide. The Quran says in Surah Rajah, chapter 13, verse number 7, وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. And to every nation have we sent a guide. Prophets were sent to each and every nation. The question posed was that which prophet was sent to India? Can we consider Ram as prophet of God, as Krishna prophet of God? And which revelation was sent to India? Can we consider Veda to be the word of God or Bhagavad Gita to be the word of God? Brother, by name, there are 25 messengers mentioned in the glorious Quran, like Adam, Noah, Abraham, Ismail, Ishaq, Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, peace be upon them all. 25 by name. So whichever the Quran mentions, we can say for sure they were prophets of Almighty God. But which are not mentioned in the Quran, what we can say, maybe. There are some politicians, Muslim politicians, who say that Ram alayhi salam, you know, Ram may peace be upon him, as though he is a prophet of God. They scratch the back of the non-Muslims so that they in turn scratch their back. See, what I say, that Quran doesn't mention Ram as the prophet of God. Quran doesn't say Krishna as the prophet of God. What I say, that maybe they were. But even if they were messengers of God, what we have to realize is that all the messengers that came, all the prophets that came before the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they were only sent for their group of people, and the message was meant for a particular time period. So even if Ram was a messenger of God, I'm not saying he is, even if he was, hypothetically, taken for granted he was, even if he was, today the Indians should not follow Ram or Krishna. Because if he was a prophet, he was only meant for that time and for those people. Today you have to follow the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who was not sent only for the Muslim or the Arab, but the Quran says in Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 107, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have sent thee not but as a mercy to the whole of humanity, as a mercy to all the creatures. The Quran says in Surah Sabah, chapter 34, verse 28, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً لِلْنَاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. That we have sent thee not but as a universal messenger, giving glad tidings and warning them against sin. But most of the human beings, they do not know. So even if Ram was a messenger, even if Lakshman was a messenger, even if Krishna was a messenger, he was meant for those people and for that time. Even if he was, today all the people in the world, whether in India, America, Europe, Arab countries, they should follow the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Similarly, the name of four revelations are given in the Holy Quran: the Torah, the Zabur, the Injil, and the Quran. Whether Veda is the word of God, whether Bhagavad Gita is the word of God, since they are not mentioned by name, I cannot say for sure they are word of God. Quran says there were revelations sent to various people, various revelations. Name of all have not been mentioned. So what I say, Bhagavad Gita may be the word of God. Raman may have been the word of God. Veda may have been the word of God. I cannot say for sure. But even if they were the word of God, since all the revelations that came before the glorious Quran, they were only meant for their people, as they were meant for a particular time period. Therefore the Quran says that since it was not meant for eternity, Allah didn't think it fit to preserve these revelations. And the glorious Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 79, it says, فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَخْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَّهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَوَيْلٌ لَّهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. That woe to those who write the book with their own hands and then say this is from Allah, to traffic with it for a miserable price. Woe to those for what they hand to write, woe to those for what they earn. That means all the revelation that came before the Quran, since they were meant only for a particular group of people, they were not meant for eternity, Allah didn't think it fit to preserve it. Therefore they have been changed. So even if Veda were the word of God, today they are not in the authentic form. Bhagavad Gita is not maintained in the original form. Besides the Quran, all the religious scriptures have been distorted. And since Quran is not meant only for the Muslims, not meant only for the Arabs, the Quran says in Surah Ibrahim, chapter 14, verse 52, that here is a message for the whole of humankind. Let them take warning therefrom. Let them know there is only one God. Let the men of understanding take heed. Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 185, Ramadan was the month in which the Quran was revealed as a guide to the humanity, as a criteria to judge right from wrong. Quran says in Surah Az-Zumur, chapter 39, verse 41, that we have revealed to thee, that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the book to instruct mankind. It doesn't say to instruct the Arabs or the Muslims, but to instruct the whole of humankind. The Quran is a revelation which is meant till eternity and for the whole of humankind. Even if Veda was the word of God, even if Bhagavad Gita was the word of God, today it has not maintained its original form. Quran says in Surah Hijr chapter 15 verse number 9, Allah will guard it from corruption. It's an uncorrupted book. So even if Veda was the word of God, it has been changed. Even if it hasn't been changed, if some people say, it was only meant for those people and for that time. Today, all the people in the world, whether living in India or America or Europe, they should follow the last and final revelation, the glorious Quran.
Question from the gent side.
Assalamu alaikum. Brother Zakir Naik, my question is, you give a shocking account of the pathetic conditions of Muslims, especially of Muslims of India, I think, that they are lagging far behind in media generally, especially in mass media, so on and so forth. They lag far behind in journalism, etc., etc. These are all the symptoms of a disease. That means one cannot be an enemy of himself. A community cannot be the enemy of itself. When the community is lagging behind in each and every aspect, to the extent that a small offshoot of the same community, that Qadianism, they are doing well. So will you be able to give the exact reason why Muslims are lagging behind in all these fields?
Well, there's a question that why are Muslims lacking behind when we know that it's a political condition, that in media we're lacking behind, in journalism, in science and technology, why we're lacking behind? Do you know, brother, at a time we were on the top. From the 8th to the 12th centuries, it was called as the Dark Ages. As the Dark Ages. Dark for whom? Dark for the Europeans. The media today projects from the 8th to 12th century Dark Ages. Who's projecting? The media. The media. It was dark for the Europeans. They were backward. The world was not backward. The world, with the limited knowledge that the Arab Muslims had, the amount of advances they made, it's tremendous. You know, there were Muslim scientists who were far advanced from the 8th to 12th century. If you know the scientific history, that Muslims were far advanced in several fields. In several. The first person who discovered the blood circulation was Ibn Nafis, 600 years after the revelation of the Quran. But today we know of William Harvey. William Harvey described blood circulation 400 years after Ibn Nafis. But no one knows about Ibn Nafis, everyone knows about William Harvey. Media is in their hand. Then further, the first person who drew the world map was the Arab, Al-Idrusi, in 1154. Mathematics, Muslims were far advanced. The zero was learned from the Indians. The Arabs introduced zero and the decimal point to the world. In trigonometry, Muslims were far advanced. If you know Al-Biruni, he was expert in trigonometry and maths. We learn about the Pythagoras theorem in school, that the square of the hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the square of the other two sides. Pythagoras theorem. Who discovered it? A Muslim. Al-Abtusi, a Muslim. He discovered it. We know about Pythagoras theorem. We don't know about Al-Abtusi. We are to blame. The media is in their hands. If you know Al-Kindi, he was expert in physics, in mathematics. He first said that all laws aren't absolute. They are relative. All physical laws are absolute. Newton, Galileo, all of them said all physical laws are absolute. Al-Kindi said, no, they're relative. It was Albert Einstein who later on did more research and propounded the theory of relativity. We know about Albert Einstein. No one knows about Al-Kindi. Shakir, Muhammad, and Ahmed, these three brothers, they gave the surface area of the earth by measuring angle at the Red Sea. When people thought the world was flat. The person who first distilled alcohol, we learn in school, Geber. What is Geber? He's Jabir ibn Hayyan. They even Latinized the name so that we don't come to know he's a Muslim. You know, Geber sounds like a Westerner, Geber. Jabir. If we say Jabir, we know it's a Muslim. When we say Geber, a Westerner. Jabir ibn Hayyan was expert in the field of chemistry. He distilled alcohol, and the word alcohol comes from the word Al-Ghul, meaning an evil spirit. We learn in a school, Geber. Jabir. 2,000 works he wrote only on chemistry. Ali ibn Abbas, expert in the field of medicine. If you know about Muhammad Zakariya Razi, he was expert. He spoke about measles and smallpox. The findings of his was tremendous. We know Avicenna. Who's Avicenna? Ali ibn Sina, Avicenna. Avicenna sounds like a Westerner. Ali ibn Sina, he's known as the Aristotle of the East. with the media in their hand. The Muslims were tremendous, they were powerful. We were on the top, we were the torch bearers. Why? Because we were close to the Quran and the Sunnah. Today, Muslims are going to the dogs, I'm saying. Dogs. You know why? We are backward. Why? Because we are going away from our religion. The reason the Westerners are advancing is because they too are going away from the religion.
The next question is, Mr. Atul Menon is keen on knowing, why do Muslims have non-veg food? Killing an animal is a ruthless, merciless act. Why do Muslims have non-veg food?
The question posed was that why do Muslims have non-veg food? Killing animal is ruthless, why don't take life, etc. You should be vegetarian. And these many of our non-Muslim friends in India, especially the Hindus and Jains, they tell us. If you analyze the set of teeth of the herbivorous animal, like the cow, the goat, the sheep, they have got flat teeth. They only eat vegetables. If you analyze the set of teeth of the carnivorous animal, lion, tiger, leopard, they have got pointed set of teeth. But if you analyze the set of teeth of the human beings, we have flat teeth as well as pointed teeth. Herbivorous teeth as well as carnivorous teeth. We have an omnivorous set of teeth. If Almighty God wanted us to have only vegetables, why did He give us this pointed teeth? Why? He wanted us to have both. Where is that non-veg? Again, the digestive system of the cow can only digest vegetables. It can't digest non-veg. The digestive system of the carnivorous animal, lion, tiger, leopard, can only digest non-veg, can't digest vegetable. The digestive system of the human being can digest both non-veg and veg. If Almighty God wanted us to have only vegetables, why did He give us a digestive system which can digest both veg and non-veg? And further, if you analyze that most of the religious scripture, whether Bible or Veda or Raman, they give permission to have non-veg. If you read the Hindu scriptures, the sages and sons, they had non-veg. They even ate beef. If you read Ayodhya Khandam, chapter number 20, chapter 26, chapter number 94, it says when Ram was sent for Banvas, he told his mother that I will have to sacrifice my tasty meat dishes. If he had to sacrifice tasty meat dishes, that means he had meat. When Ram can have meat, why can't you have meat? People may not know the details of Ramayana, but they surely know the outline story of Ramayana, that when Ram was sent for Banvas, even his wife Sita accompanied him. And once Sita asked Ram to kill the buck. You may be knowing the story, you know it comes on the television and comic strips, that Sita asked Ram to kill the buck. You ask a Hindu friend, why did Sita ask Ram to kill the buck, to kill the deer? So some people may argue, oh, maybe Sita wanted a pet. So you ask, that if Sita wanted a pet, what will Sita do with a dead pet? She asked Ram to kill the buck because she wanted to eat the meat. There's no other answer. So when she can have non-veg, why can't you have non-veg? Now there are some of the people who argue are saying that if you analyze, Hindu scriptures give permission. But the reason why they even became vegetarian is because they were being influenced by other philosophies like Jainism, etc., which believed in ahimsa. Now if you argue with the Jain and you argue with these Hindus now who have given up non-veg, some of them, when you ask them why should we not have non-veg, so they will tell you, non-veg is killing living creatures. If you kill living creatures, bad. Therefore you should have only plants. Today science is advanced and we have come to know that even plants are living creatures. Previously people thought plants have no life. But today we have come to know even plants are living creatures, they have life. So the argument has changed. Yes, Brother Zakir, we know that plants have life. But you know, plants can't feel pain. Therefore, killing a plant is less a sin as compared to killing an animal. Today, science has further advanced and we have come to know, even the plants can feel pain. They can even cry. They even feel happy. Do you know that? Researchers show to us today that the plants even feel happy. They can even cry. They feel pain. But the thing is, you cannot hear their cry. Because the human frequency is from 20 cycles per second to 20,000 cycles per second. Anything below and above this you can't hear. You know silent dog whistle? The dog can hear till 40,000 cycles per second. So the silent dog whistle is the frequency above 20,000 cycles per second so that the human beings can't hear, but below 40,000 cycles per second so that the dog can hear. So when the master whistles, the dog comes running, but human beings can't hear. So similarly, when the cry given out by the plant, the human beings can't hear because it is not within the range of the human hearing. But even the plants, they cry. There was a non-Muslim who had the maximum argument with me. He said, okay, brother, I agree with you. Plants have got life. Plants can feel pain. But you know, plants have got lesser senses. They have got 2 or 3 senses. Animal has got 5 senses. Therefore, killing an animal is a bigger crime. So I said, I agree with you. For sake of argument, I agree with you that plants have got lesser senses, animals have got more senses. But I ask you a question, that suppose your brother, he is born deaf and dumb, 2 senses less, deaf and dumb. When he grows up, afterwards, someone comes and kills him. So will you go and tell the judge, oh me Lord, give the murderer less punishment because my brother had 2 senses less, he was dumb and he was deaf. In fact, you will tell him, usne to masoom ko mara hai. He has killed an innocent person. You should give him double punishment. In Islam, the Quran gives permission that you can have meat. Quran says in Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse number 1, you can have the meat of the cattle, of the animal, 4-footed animal, with the exception name. Quran further says in Surah Al-Hajj, chapter 16, verse number 5, that of the meat you can eat. Quran says in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse 21, that in the cattle is an instructive sign for you. We give you milk to drink from the bodies, and in them are various benefits of the meat you can eat. So very well, because Quran says you can have the good things that we have provided, there's no problem at all in having non-veg. Hope that answers the question.
There is a related question asked by another non-Muslim brother. Brother Giriraj would like to know, science tells us that whatever you eat has an effect on your behavior. Why does Islam allow Muslims to eat non-veg food? Because eating of animals makes a person violent and ferocious. Please explain.
The brother asked a question that whatever you eat has an effect on a behavior, and I do agree with that. That's a scientific explanation. Whatever you have has an effect on a behavior. So why do you all have non-veg? Because you are non-veg, you all are ferocious people, you know, all violent, fighting and terrorism and attacking. What you all eat has an effect on a behavior, and I do agree, science tells. That what you eat, it has certain things, certain times it has the effect on the behavior. Therefore, the Quran says in Surah Araf, chapter 7, verse 157, it says that the Prophet has allowed you things which are good and has prohibited you from having things which are bad. He's made for you permissible things which are benefit for you and has prohibited you from having things which are wrong for you. That's the reason in Islam, the Prophet said, it's mentioned Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, you are not allowed to have the meat of the carnivorous animal like tiger, leopard, cat, etc. We are only allowed to have the meat of the herbivorous animal. You know, carnivorous animals, they are ferocious. We have meat of the herbivorous animal like cow, goat, sheep. So we have to behave, you know, as mild and as soft like the cow, like the goat, like the sheep. So whatever you eat has an effect on the behavior. We eat cow, beef, meat of the sheep and goat, which are herbivorous animals, you know, domestic animal, loving animal. We are not allowed to have meat of the canine animal, like, you know, tiger, lion, leopard, neither of the rodents like rat and reptiles. Our Prophet said in Sahih Bukhari, neither birds of prey like falcons, vultures, etc. So these are Prophet prohibited. Therefore, we are kind and peace-loving people.
Thank you, Dr. Zakir Naik. The question answer session is over. Now I would like to ask our chairman, Mr. Saduddin Salih, to give a briefing.
Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, As-salatu was-salamu ala Rasul Kareem. Dr. Zakir Naik, brothers and sisters, except one lady, I thank Almighty Allah for having given me this opportunity to be with you and also to hear the scholarly vocabulary of Dr. Zakir Naik. He is an asset to the community, and not only to our community but to the mankind as a whole. We want such Zakir Naiks in many more numbers to discuss, not only give a speech, to discuss the questions which are coming like firing stones from the audience, and he can explain it better, thereby thwarting the disbelief and misunderstanding in our community as well as inter-communities. So I pray Almighty Allah to grant him strength and long life, and also congratulate his Islamic Research Foundation who are in this yeoman service. I also congratulate at this juncture the team of Abdul Salam Puttige, my brother, and Mr. Yasin Sahai, who are actually in the field of Madhyama, which is the topic today. They are starting a daily newspaper. I congratulate him, and also I thank the organizers for having given me this opportunity. Thank you, one and all. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
The last item for today's topic is vote of thanks. I thank our chairman, Mr. Sali, for having come here and accepted the invitation and conducted the meeting in a very nice way. And Dr. Zakir Naik, who has come all the way from Bombay and giving an excellent and thought-provoking speech and making us learn more about Islam and the religion. I also thank Muhammad Yasin Malpe and also Abdul Salam Puttige and for conducting these meetings. Thanks for all the audience for a patient hearing. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.